Hold up. Here we are. We are recording. Give it up for yourselves, y'all. Round of applause. We made it. We found the Zoom link. We're here. Half the battle is won. Welcome to Modern Management of the Older Adult Essential Foundations. We are super pumped to have y'all here. First off, right out the gate, if you haven't yet, change your name to your Instagram handle. We like to do lots of stories. We like to tag y'all as well, just to continue to spread kind of that old, not weak message. We are going to very quickly introduce ourselves as the MMOA faculty, but we want to get in a good idea of who is in this cohort. All right. So if you wouldn't mind, type in the chat box what your vocation is, what setting you're in, and kind of where you're located. Also, if this is your first ICE course. All right, if this is your first ICE course, go ahead and put that in there. But your vocation, what setting you find yourself in, and then where you're located in the US or across the globe. All right, so I want you to meet the MOA squad real quick. Ellen, Kachepi, who are you? Tell us about yourself.
What's up, everybody? Hello, my name is Ellen Seppi, or Kachepi. I'm an outpatient physical therapist in Littleton, Colorado. I treat patients with geriatric conditions, neurological conditions, and orthopedic conditions. I'm so glad you're all here.
Awesome. All right, Charlottesville, Virginia, lovely place. First ICE course, hell yeah, that's awesome. Sam Chamberlain, tell us about yourself. Or hold on, are you good?
I'm good. All right. I am Samantha Chamberlain. I'm in Northeast Oklahoma and have a grand opening of adaptable physical therapy tomorrow, private practice outpatient clinic. And yeah, love teaching with the older adult crew.
Love it. Congratulations.
Thank you.
On that. That's awesome. JB.
Hey, everyone. My name is Julie. I am a PT in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I do a mix of home health and private wellness at older adults' homes.
Beautiful. Awesome. Jeff Musgrave.
What's up, team? My name's Jeff. I am a PT in Lexington, Kentucky. Got a little bit of experience from acute all the way through outpatient fitness currently. Focused on fitness in Lexington at Stronger Life HQ.
Awesome. Prevet.
Hi, everyone. So I'm a Canadian transplant here now in just outside of Charlotte, North Carolina. I previously owned an outpatient gym rehab model with my husband, but now I am mostly in the research space. And so my research focuses on high intensity resistance training for at-risk older adults. And so basically my work has been about putting barbells into the hands of older adults to show that they are old and not weak.
Preach. My name's Dustin, PT, Lexington, Kentucky, mainly in the fitness space at Stronger Life in Lexington. And we got quite the crew here, man. Look at this. We have lots of OTs, which is awesome. We've got folks in acute care. We got home healthers. We got sniffers. We've got outpatient folks. We have folks across the country, lots of first-time ICERs as well. Welcome. Welcome to the cult, if you will. The family, I should say. PTAs, awesome. Heck yeah. So as you all are kind of going up through that chat and seeing the diversity of this group, this is really valuable. We experience this in our live or online courses. We also experience this in our live courses, if you've been to that as well, is whenever we have folks from all different settings, even different vocations like PT versus OT, and we come together in the same quote unquote room to try and become better clinicians, better coaches for these folks, like we all walk away better as a result. We really value the opinions of all of these different types of people, and that's really going to contribute to the conversation. So everyone's going to have a different perspective on a lot of these issues and things that we talk about, and we really like to hear that. So whether it's here in the chat, whether you unmute, whether you drop a question in the student doc, we really value your all's thoughts. You don't get a lot of continuing education where you're going to have clinicians from different types of settings in the same room. By and large, like outpatient folks, when you go to like, let's say a manual therapy heavy con ed course, who all's there? It's all outpatient clinicians, right? It's so helpful to hear folks that are in a different part of that healthcare sector because your patients are experiencing those different sectors. Awesome. This is cool to see. So Here's what to expect. We will start 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We'll hit record right at 8:01. We're going to get right into it. We're going to talk more about the content, maybe take a different twist on things, maybe some new material that may be out related to the research, but we're going to dive a little bit deeper into that week's content and then spend some time on assignment review. And then we'll have usually about 15, 20 minutes for student questions. So if we don't have a lot of student questions, it may be a short call. If we have a lot of questions, it may be a little bit longer, but if you don't want to sit through those questions, feel free to tune out after we get through the assignment review. The student question piece, we have one question this week. That is one of the many opportunities that you have to really get the most out of this course. So we highly encourage you all to drop questions in that student document. But that is the gist of it. And each week we're going to have a different theme, different assignment, but you got through week one, you get the gist of it. We love the chat box, especially for these evenings when we have, this time to dive a little bit deeper into these topics. We're going to ask y'all some questions. The chat box is where we love for y'all to respond. It's already rocking and rolling here, which is Thailand. Oh my gosh, that is awesome. So chat box, you could also raise your hand and unmute. Raise your hand is in the feature that where you can actually hit that raise hand button, and then we're able to see and we'll be able to call on you. So we'll have some parts of tonight and weeks ahead where we'll discuss things. And then last, but certainly not least, if it is an ICE course, whether it is live, whether it is online, you got to be ready to move, right? We are fitness forward clinicians. We like to practice what we preach, and we're going to do that here by flashing this hashtag. Can anyone finish that hashtag for me that you see in yellow there in the chat box? Yeah, Sarah, that's what I'm talking about. Yeah, I love it. I love it. So that is going to randomly pop up at some point tonight. All right. The first person that submits week is exempt from doing 10 burpees. The rest of us have to do 10 burpees. The speaker, whoever that's going to be, will do 5 so we don't get too out of breath. All right. So 10 burpees, standing, chest to deck, all the way up tall. Got it? Good. Awesome. All right. Week one, the F word. Who here learned about the F word in your formal training? The F word being frailty. Think back to your formal training. Think back to maybe the course that you had on geriatrics, maybe the lecture that you had. We see a lot of variability. Who here actually learned about frailty in your formal training? Just type in the chat box for me. Yes. All right. If so, how much was it covered? Did you have a lecture? Was it several lectures, course? Was it covered in detail? We got a couple yeses out the gate. One lecture, says Micah. MMOA faculty, go ahead and drop your experience with frailty in your formal training as well. Rego says a few lectures. Julia just says, nah, very little discussion on frailty in my program, says Shannon. Jeff and I went to the same school. Big negative, minimal. So we see a theme here, right? We see a lot of variability amongst different programs, especially in the realm of physical therapy. We see some programs that may have that, geriatric champion that's really pushing to advocate for this type of content, to where you may get a few lectures, maybe even a course. But by and large, it is not covered in depth. And we feel like this is an absolutely missed opportunity to really shape the future clinicians in terms of how they perceive their value in this population. Because if we're going to talk about better serving these folks, better serving older adults, the folks on this call with your rehabilitation, fitness forward background, in training, you have so much to give to these folks. And if anyone is going to know about frailty, it needs to be us. It needs to be us. We have so much to give. So we covered a lot, for this week one. Christina covered a lot about frailty and some of the different measures that we can use for kind of conceptualizing this kind of abstract term. One of the ones that we really want to bring a lot of your attention to is that Fried's physical phenotype. If you recall Christina talking about that. Remember, what those are is if you have 0 traits that you see the traits to the right, you are considered to be robust. 1 to 2 traits, you are pre-frail. 3 or more, you're going to be frail. those traits to review are physical inactivity, gait speed, the big number for many of you all, especially all the outpatient folks, it's at 1 meter per second. If they're slower than that, a weight loss, if they lost more than 10 pounds or 10% body weight without meaning to in the past 6 months, reported fatigue or lethargy, and then muscular weakness categorized by low grip strength or a low SPPB under 8 out of 12. SPP is short physical performance battery, and you're going to spend more time on that next week. So based on that, we are able to identify those traits, and we're able to get somewhat of a good idea of where these folks fall on this spectrum right here. Frailty, someone is frail, someone is pre-frail, someone is robust. And this is how we want you to think about frailty. It's not like this arbitrary diagnosis that you just put on someone and that dictates this whole plan of care. It doesn't necessarily work like that. We want you to think about this concept on a spectrum, that your patients are going to be all over the place on this spectrum, from frail to pre-frail to robust. Now, I want you to think about, let's go back here to these traits. 0 traits is robust, 1 to 2 traits is pre-frail, 3 or more traits are frail. Type yes in the chat box if you are treating folks that are considered to be frail. Full frailty, 3 or more traits. Lots of yeses. Lots of yeses. If you recall of the different settings that we find in this cohort, there's a lot of outpatient clinicians, right? Lots of outpatient folks and lots of frailty. This is something to keep in mind. Oftentimes when we think about frailty, we think it can look a certain way, right? We think it's the person that's probably max assist. They spend a lot of time in their chair, right? They've got a lot of wrinkles, not very mobile, but you can have someone that is considered to be frail and a community dwelling older adult that's walking into that outpatient clinic, right? Now think about pre-frail. Let's go back to that. 1 to 2 traits. I want you to just guesstimate the percentage of your caseload that would be considered to be pre-frail. 1 to 2 traits. What percentage of your caseload of the folks that you work with are considered to be pre-frail? If you're in the home health setting, you're probably going to be north of 99, I would imagine. Outpatient, you're going to be probably the majority of your folks. If you're like most outpatient clinics where you're seeing a lot of folks that are on Medicare, a lot, right? A lot. So we have a lot of folks that are on the spectrum that are in some of the more stereotypical settings that we would think we'd find them in, right? The SNFs, home health, a lot of folks in acute care, right? But my gosh, these folks are also walking amongst us in the community. They're going to Trader Joe's. They're going to Target. These folks are out in the community. And what we want you to really think about is when we have this much frailty, if you will, in this population, that this is a huge opportunity for us. And if it's an opportunity here at MMOA, we'll feel like this is an obligation as well. Especially when we're talking to this crowd that has the tools to influence this spectrum, likely more than any other healthcare provider. And we mean that in all sincerity. When you think about your training, how much time you get with folks, the frequency of your touch points, the fact that you're able to get people up and moving and increase their physical activity levels and influence all these other lifestyle factors that Christina covered that can contribute to some of these things, we can touch all of them. And that is an opportunity. That is also an obligation. And this is our goal, right? This is what we are trying to do with the vast majority of our folks, is we see this decline over time. It fluctuates, but overall, we see this decline. And the result of that decline is so many of our folks, they live long, right? But they die slowly. If you're in the SNF, you see this on a daily basis. You have folks that are probably going to live a relatively long life, but they're going to have a steady, slow decline. And it is tough to watch. But there's a lot that we can do about that. We can increase people's capacity. We can get them as fit as possible. And if we're able to achieve that, then we're likely able to help them live long, but also die fast, which is the goal for every single person here, right? We want to maintain our capacities for a long period of time, And when we do go, we want it to be quick. That is what we're after. And what you're going to see the rest of this course is going to revolve around this graph. How do we get folks in particular away from this red line so they're not one rep max living, but they are also maximizing their capacity so they can live long and die fast? That's what this whole course is about. This is a huge opportunity. It's also a huge obligation. We want you all to know that. All right. A funky. I like it. That's a good Instagram handle. You don't have any burpees. That's great. Everyone else has 10. I've got 5. All right. Full standing. Get your chest down to the ground or lower surface like a couch or ottoman. Then come back up standing. Ready? Go. All right, as you're finishing up your 10th burpee, if you have any questions about frailty, anything that you wanted to discuss a little bit further or clarify, you can type that in the chat box. We didn't have any questions in the student document, so we're going to assume that everything was loud and clear. But if you need to understand this, because this is a foundation for everything that is to come. It's an opportunity. It's also an obligation. All right. So frailty is the big one. Frailty is the big one. Also, the perceptions of aging is another big one and something that we really want to bring your attention to. Who found these studies pretty surprising? If this is the first time you've heard of some of this literature, this is kind of a pretty wild area of geriatric literature where, you know, they're taking these age stereotypes and just looking at all kinds of different outcomes, and they're seeing some pretty consistent themes. And it should have been very, one, eye-opening, but it should get you thinking about these age stereotypes of what's your age stereotype, right? Hopefully you had an opportunity to self-reflect on, do I have a positive or negative age stereotype, and reflect on how that could influence your life in the future and the outcomes like we discussed in this lecture, but then also how does that influence our patients? There's a lot to unpack here. The big thing in terms of what we can do about this that we want you all to walk away with is that concept of implicit exposures to positive age stereotypes, all right? We covered some of the research that compares explicit versus implicit interventions. And by and large, those implicit interventions, when you're not being aware of being intervened upon, that you are influenced, that your perceptions of aging are influenced over time. And like the study that we showed where that could be literally, you know, a 8 to 12 week period, or it may be 8 to 12 months, right? Depending on that exposure, but it's that implicit exposure. There's lots of ways that we can do this, right? You know, mass media is a big one, right? We're all being implicitly intervened upon every single day when you're scrolling, you know, through social media, when you're watching TV, when you see the billboards, when you get those commercials, those are all shaping your perceptions and your beliefs, right? We can use that as well. Social media is an easy one, right? That's one that the MMOA crowd leans heavily upon to influence hopefully our profession, but then also the people in our communities that we're trying to serve. We talked about decor, right? Of the nice generic courage posters versus like the action shots of your target demographic doing something fun, or God forbid, having a smile on their face, maybe doing something active or something that represents a positive age stereotype per se. And then that intentional exposure where we're connecting folks with other positive age stereotypes. Now, I want you all to reflect and want to take some time to either type in the chat box or we can unmute to think about this. How can you implicitly expose your communities to positive age stereotypes? How can you implicitly expose your communities to positive age stereotypes? And what we like to do at MMOA, and if you've been to live, you know this, is that if you have an idea about something or if you plan to do something, we love it when you say it out loud. Or when you type it. because the odds of you actually doing that go up dramatically. How can you implicitly expose your community, your network, to positive age stereotypes? Would love to hear your thoughts and ideas, whether in the chat box or unmuting. As you all are thinking about that, Courtney said, highly recommend Breaking the Aging Code. Really brings your awareness to age stereotypes and ageism. Awesome. If Julie, Jeff, you wouldn't mind dropping the link for that. I haven't got through that one yet. My copy's around here somewhere. Mark, multi-generational gatherings. Awesome. Mark, would you mind expand on that a little bit? Is that in the context of like family or in the context of work?
Yeah, I mean, I think it can be both, but probably easiest to first do that in the context of family.
Yeah, 100%. And there's some really good research behind some of those, especially some of those programs where we are getting different generations interacting. That influences usually the older adults in a positive manner. It also really influences the younger crowd as well. Awesome. We're seeing that at Stronger Life. We've got several parent-child members that are both over 55 that are working out in fitness classes together. And that whole dynamic is an absolutely beautiful thing, which is pretty cool to see. Yeah, that's been a recent development. It's been pretty interesting. Awesome. Thanks for dropping that, Jeff and Julie. Any other ideas, thoughts? What about in your work? Choosing active activities with my 50-year-old plus friends. Yep, 100%, Betsy. 100%. Clinic decor is one. That intentional exposure scheduling is another. What's that, Ellen?
So in our clinic, we have 10 clinicians, and they're named Brittany, Lauren, blah, 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 but their names spell out Blessed Margs. So we're having a fitness competition right now called the Blessed Margs 30. Yeah. And if patients do the challenge with us, every day the exercise list gets longer by one. And if the patients do the challenge with us, they get to put a sticker on the board. And it's kind of cool to be able to point out the stickers and say, the donut has Parkinson's disease and a spinal fusion and a hip replacement. And everybody's kind of excited about it.
The donut. I like it. That's awesome. Nice titling on that. Julie says, having your older adult patients follow anti-ageism Instagram accounts. Julie, drop your favorite ones if you want to. Move with Jamie. Offer community events and ensure is understood. Everyone is welcome. Do nature hike every Tuesday and people from 6 to 75 come and join and give them opportunities to participate. That is awesome. That's a multi-generational activity there for sure. Awesome. So this is something we want you all to think about, right? And you're going to get more kind of ammo as this course progresses. But we want you to start thinking about this on the front end, right? Because yes, you're going to better serve older adults. You're going to be able to eval, treat, discharge, dispo better as a result of this course. That's the main goal. But we are trying to get people to think differently about aging, about age stereotypes. And we want you all to be an active participant in challenging the common narratives that we see. So continue to think about that. We're going to give y'all way more ammo as time progresses. Awesome. Julie's dropping some really good accounts in there. This Chair Rocks, Ashton Applewhite. She is an incredible human being that has really spearheaded a lot of the ageism conversation. Really good TED Talk. Alex has a signed copy of her book, I believe, which is awesome. So one way that we like to challenge a lot of these narratives is with this account, Old Not Weak. If someone could drop the link for the Old Not Weak account in there, that'd be great. So this account, we like to share a lot of really good stories, things that are just kind of challenging the normal narrative around what it means to be an older adult. This is our attempt to really challenge that. There's a lot of clinicians that follow this, but also a lot of masters athletes, for example, a lot of folks that are not related to the rehab space or ICE whatsoever will follow this account as well. This is one example of something that you all could do with your clinic page, for example, or your own account, of just some of these things that we can do to slowly influence folks and expose them to some of these amazing stories and really interesting stories that many of you all submitted. All right, so let's get into some of these assignments. Type yes in the chat box if you had fun with this assignment. This one is always fun for us to see. Just some of these stories, some of these videos, you know, it's just really interesting to see these continue to grow as well and continue to change. That's really, really awesome to witness. One of the more common ones that we'll see is this
You got to meet the 105-year-old lady from Louisiana who ran 100 meters and set a world record.
We went
to meet Miss Julia Hawkins and expected she'd be real excited to talk about the race, but she told us it's just a drop in the bucket when it comes to the race of life.
On your marks. Set.
And she's off at 105 years old in a class all by herself and with a fresh picked flower in her hair. Julia Hawkins was running for the record books at the Louisiana Senior Olympic Games. She is running 105-year-old ladies.
So 105-year-old, the Hurricane Hawkins, is what she's probably, I think 106, 107 at this point. She is the world record holder in the 100-meter dash because she doesn't have any competitors. She's the only person still racing at that distance in her age group. And just an incredible story. She was pretty late to the game in terms of running. And she is still absolutely crushing. I do believe this past week, on the male side of things, the 100 meter dash for the 100-year-old division was broken this week. So people like Julia the Hurricane Hawkins there's going to be more of them as time progresses. She'll kind of be considered a normal person maybe in about 20, 30 years as some of these other folks continue to progress. But amazing story. Here's another one. 66-year-old man completes 7 marathons in 7 days on 7 continents. Think about this. One day in late January, Robert Owens ran a marathon in Antarctica. And then the next day, after sleeping on the plane, ran one in South Africa. Next came successive marathons in Australia and then Dubai, then Portugal, then Colombia, and then finally Miami. Insane. 7 marathons, 7 days. 7 continents. He happens to be 66 years old. Gnarly. That is crazy. Flo, another track and field athlete.
Flo, Philly, and Miler.
Flo
may seem like any other grandmother. It's so beautiful here. Turns out she's anything but. At age 85, she is a running, jumping, leaping pole vaulter. Yes, you heard that right. She's 85.
With a nobody, if you don't use it, you're gonna lose it.
It's a sport she learned in retirement, going from spectator to participant in her 60s.
I did see some ladies doing the polvo, and they weren't going very high. And I said to myself, wow, that looks like it could be very challenging. I want to try that.
They weren't going very high. I'm gonna try this. Picked pole vaulting up in her 60s. We have any pole vaulters in here in this crowd? Pole vaulters are they're a very unique breed of athletes. They're usually the adventure seekers, adrenaline junkies, usually have a few screws loose up top. They're kind of crazy. And Flo decided at the age of 66 to take on this very risky sport. What's really interesting too is that Flo, I had the chance to meet her last summer. They had the national, the Masters National Track and Field Championships here in Lexington, and she was competing there and she was doing pole vault, and that's kind of what she's known for. But she competed in about 7 different events that weekend. And I was talking to her after she got done with pole vaulting, and we had to cut off our conversation very abruptly because she had to go warm up for long jump. And then she had 400 meter dash right after her long jump. She was just going. But pole vaulting is what she's known for. Picked it up at 66. That is wild. Here's another good story.
Hey, It's a night of clubbing the way it should be, with hypnotic beats and rising temperatures. But the person spinning the vinyl isn't a teenager. It's a rising star on the DJing scene. 69-year-old grandmother Ruth Flowers, alias DJing Mammy Rock.
I may be just a five-minute wonder. And if I am, so be it. I may be up there and down the next. But I take life as it comes. Each day is a new day. Live each day, I say to everybody. You can sit on your backside and do nothing. Or you can get up and do what you wanted to do all your life. And, you know, that's entirely up to every individual.
Flowers made her debut as a DJing at the 2009 Cannes Film Festival. Since then, she's become a media phenomenon.
Wild, wild story. Yes, exactly, Christina. Christy, I feel like this is going to be you. Here's the story is, is Mammy Rock, the DJ, she was widowed and lost her husband. And this is like the first thing that she went and did. I could see my wife, Megan, doing this as well. When I pass, that she's going to go off and start her DJ career. Just something, you know, completely left field. Christina, she's probably going to go back to being a Zoom instructor, if I'm going to bet money on that. But Mammy Rock, just some of the words that she said are DJ Dr. Jump, man, you don't want that. You don't want that, Jeff. No way. Nah. And that's wild. That's absolutely wild. And we're seeing more and more stories of this. Here's one, another student submission of a student that actually knows this person, Dave. Dave is old, not weak. Dave has had some orthopedic challenges over the 20 years, over the years, disc herniation, ACL rupture, rotator cuff tear, and knee arthritis. He and his wife discovered CrossFit in 2017. Since then, he's lost over 30 pounds, rehabilitated his old injuries, surgeries, including a hip replacement. He is the head coach for the Vitality program at CrossFit Mafia. 3 days a week, you will find Dave coaching the 11 a.m. Vitality class, filled with his peers, learning new skills, challenging one another, and pushing their limits. Dave is an inspiration, is empowering those around to be the best version of themselves possible. We got folks like Dave walking amongst us, right? A lot of us know folks like Dave. A lot of us are infatuated with a lot of these stories. Mammy Rock, the Hurricane, Flo Miler, all of them, right? We love these stories. We push them out on a regular basis, and we're going to keep pushing them out on a regular basis. But one thing that we want to be very, very careful about is that we don't want to swap out ageism for ableism. We don't want to swap ageism for ableism. Ableism is discrimination in favor of able-bodied people. And what we can often see is that we can kind of put these folks on this pedestal, the Hurricanes, the Flows, the Daves, for example, and basically put them up on the pedestal, and anyone that is not reaching their heights is not considered to be crushing it, is not considered to be aging well or aging successfully. And that is the last thing that we want to portray. You're going to hear more about this next week when we talk about diving into the nebulous term of successful aging, of what that looks like for each patient that we serve and how it's going to look different. We're all not going to try to push folks to be like Julia the Hurricane Hawkins, and that is perfectly fine. So we want to be very careful to swap that ageism for ableism. Very good article and book recommendation is going to be coming out in MMOA Digest on Friday. Julie Brower found a really, really cool book and had some really interesting reflections, and we're going to be talking more about that on Friday. If someone could drop that MMOA Digest link, be sure to be on that list. If you're not, it's a biweekly email where we send out recent research articles that are going to be helpful. You're going to hear more about this topic this Friday. Awesome. Move with Jamie said, just this week, my patient who status post left elbow ORF brought in her mat she makes out of plastic bags. They are 6 by 3 feet, take her about 32 hours to make. She then donates them to homeless shelters. One of the goals is to gain enough grip strength back to be able to do this activity again. Hell yeah. That's awesome. That's awesome. So let's not swap ageism for ableism. Let's share some of these stories that I think are more familiar to a lot of our work, right? Where yes, some of these folks are not going to the national senior games. They're not breaking world records, but they're continuing to attack life in a manner that is important to them. And that's something that we want to celebrate. 84-year-old patient who is in rehab for general debility and CHF exacerbation worked together for almost 2 weeks on cardiovascular endurance, strengthening, balance. She would get fatigued after a short 50-foot walk with the rolling walker. At the beginning of our time together, she progressed. I started implementing some higher level balance activities with her. I like to dance with my patients to work on endurance, multi-directional walking, turning, and stepping, plus the fun activity that most patients haven't felt safe to do before. That's absolutely amazing. Think about where this person was, fatigued after a 50-foot walk with that rolling walker at the beginning of their time together. They progress, and now she's letting her rip, unsupported, dancing, doing the Macarena. That's awesome. But just that drive that she is continuing to fight for something that she believes in, to be able to do the things that she wants to do. This is an example of a positive age stereotype. She is not going to the senior games. She's not going to break a world record, but it's still something that we want to celebrate. Oma, another example. First day she walked into clinic, heavily relied on two hiking sticks, did not want to use a walker. We know lots of folks like that, right? Was staring at the floor and dragging her feet with every step. She could barely tolerate low-level activities and needed several rest breaks due to fatigue. She told me that she really wanted to be independent again because she hated relying on her daughter for help. Felt like she was too old at 88 to get much better. And now, hinging, deadlifting, picking up a 15-pound kettlebell off the ground. And for, we got to keep this in context, right? Because for many folks, especially if you spend a lot of time, you know, in the realm of fitness, if you spend a lot of time around kettlebells, for example, you look at a 15-pound kettlebell deadlift and you're like, all right, yeah, whatever, cool, Oma, let's bump that up a little bit. But if you think about what this means, that this woman who likely had never seen or touched a kettlebell before went from where she was and continued to fight and fight and fight to the point and be willing enough to try an intimidating exercise with an intimidating piece of equipment like this and to pick that weight up off the ground. That is absolutely huge. That is awesome. And these are the things that we want to celebrate. Oma, absolutely crushing it. Bill, here's another one. 71-year-old male happens to be not only my patient, but my father. A couple of years ago, he became an incomplete C4 quad due to septic infection. He had less than a 3% rate of survival. Five surgeries were completed in the first 8 days to decompress the cervical spine and lumbar spine, remove his right shoulder prosthesis, remove his right hip prosthesis, and excise other multiple infections. Gnarly. Here is Bill now. Shoulder, hip revised, continuing to improve each day. Truthfully, I sought after him not only to benefit him, but my entire patient caseload. Because of MMOA, my father, patients walking, deadlifting, squatting, resistance sled pushing, and much more. His long-term goal, two-year goal, was to be independent in a wheelchair. In a wheelchair. And now he's doing stuff like this. Hell yeah, Bill. Awesome. So these stories, right? We're going to keep highlighting them. We're going to talk about the hurricanes. We're going to talk about the flows. But the Bills, the Almas, the folks doing the Macarena, right? Like those stories we still want to highlight as well, and highlight the folks that they may be reaching a goal that is nowhere near related to physical capacity or physical improvement or physical independence, right? We want to broaden our perspective of positive age stereotype beyond what we typically associate it with, all right? We're still going to preach that old, not weak message. Do not hear us incorrectly there, but we want to have a broader perspective of things. Be sure to check out that article we're going to share on Friday. Awesome. Good work, y'all. Awesome job on the assignments. So what you're going to see now as you've gotten your first round of assignments, you're going to see a little bit more practical application of the material where you may be filming yourself doing an outcome measure or a particular exercise. We're going to be doing lots of those types of activities. You're going to have opportunity to do a programming assignment as well. And so we're going to shift gears a little bit, but we just wanted to start things off on a high note by searching the interwebs for some of these stories. Y'all crushed that. So good work. Good work. All right, student questions. It is awesome. 8:41. We had one student question. Micah's on the call here. We'll tackle this. We'll continue to talk about this type of scenario through the course, but this will be a good conversation right now. Remember, these student questions, y'all, use it, because we want to make sure you get out of this course what you want, all right? So make sure that all the material is clear. So Micah said, I'm treating a patient with peripheral neuropathy, primarily affecting his strength, which has severely impacted activity tolerance. He has stopped PT before because he thinks it made him worse. So I started with very conservative dosing. You're going to see that referred to as intentional underdosage as you progress through this course. Each time he comes back to me, he reports being way too exhausted after exercise. He's had 4 sessions and Mike has decreased his volume of activities each time. I'm struggling to find intensity that matters while keeping his buy-in. Maybe this is a question for later in the course, but it's on my mind a lot. Well, if it's on your mind, Micah, we're going to talk about it. So I'll share my thoughts. I know the MOA crew will have some thoughts as well. This is I would say, Micah, type in the chat box what setting you find yourself in. But I'll speak to my experience, which is largely in the home health setting, where this would be a very, very consistent scenario of fatigue management of, man, I think I am being rather conservative, but they're still reporting they're absolutely exhausted. All right. So first thing that we like to think about with this is exactly what you're doing. You are trying to achieve intensity. And so you thought, okay, I still want intensity, so I'm going to reduce the volume. That was a really good move. That's probably the first thing that many of us are going to do is we're still going to try and hit it hard. We may do less of that activity. So awesome job there. When you have something like this where you're changing those variables, you're reducing volume. It's the fourth visit. You see this consistent theme of they're rather exhausted. We got to look at some other variables. There's several, but these are things that we do want to think about. One is, what time of day are you having your sessions? Has it been a consistent time of day? And what has their life been like kind of leading up to that? How was their sleep the night before? How was their nutrition? How was their hydration, for example? Trying to play with that time, if you're seeing a consistent theme at the same schedule, could be low-hanging fruit. So like in the home health setting, it may be, all right, let's maybe shift that to later in the afternoon versus first thing in the morning, all right? Or come whenever they don't have some other activities they need to do, like a doctor's visit or do their laundry or whatever it may be. So that's the first thing second thing. Third thing would be timing of medications. If someone has diabetic or peripheral neuropathy, their medication list, I could imagine, is probably pretty solid. When are they taking, look at some of these medications and see, do they contribute to relative fatigue, lethargy? When are they taking those? Can we adjust the timing of that? The timing of medications, especially when there's a lot of medical complexities on board, could be the difference between you getting a solid session or not. All right. So those are the big three things, not all the things, but the big three things that first come to my mind. MOA crew, what other thoughts do you have for Micah in this common scenario that we'll run across?
Some of the things that you could do to still be getting some strength training, but maybe it's a little bit more tolerable. When we have older adults and we compare power training to strength training, in general, when you're doing heavier loading, people report higher residual fatigue for the rest of the day than power-based training. So you can switch, like bring the weights really far down and start working on power trainings. So trying to do things as quickly as possible and applying a lot of rest. Sometimes too, like setting up the expectation that, you know, I get really tired after exercise too, if I'm pushing it really hard. And it depends on the client. Like some people, if they're saying that they're too exhausted and they can't actually do their activities of daily living, then we definitely want to make sure that we're catering the program. But sometimes, you know, saying it's okay that you're tired for a little bit after. When I go for a run, I'm really tired too. And it's because we worked really hard to get our muscles really strong. And we want to there's going to be a little bit of time after exercise when our body is really trying. Micah said, to be clear, he's okay in session with me, but his biggest concern is about his home exercise program, dose 2-3 times a week. He agreed. Okay. So maybe start with twice a week then. You know, the dose for hitting those exercise guidelines is two times a week at an appropriate intensity. So if you give him a good dose of intensity in session and then tell him, all I need you to do is do it one other time, but work hard in that one other time, then you'll see some improvements and it'll be adhering to all of our exercise guidelines for older adults. I love this question. Yeah. Agreed.
And too, like with someone like this gentleman that, I mean, this is a big change for him, I would imagine. You know, like think about what his, I'm making a lot of assumptions, but like his physical activity levels prior to this bout of care, what they are likely, where they're likely at, and then what we're asking them to do. It's a big change, a pretty drastic change, even though it may not sound like a ton, but relatively for that person, it's a big change, and it can have some of these, you know, side effects. And if you're able to stretch out this course of care over a longer period of time, you know, likely he's not going to be wiped out after a lot of these sessions like he is initially. These are all good things to think about. There's lots of dials that we can pull here, which is a good thing.
I have another little note to add, maybe, Micah, that, you know, I have a lot of patients right now, like two, that have post-polio syndrome. And those patients with post-polio syndrome have this, you know, view of their muscles slowly disintegrating to dust with exercising, because a lot of healthcare workers kind of paint it out like that. And peripheral neuropathy, you know, for that would be scary to just know that for no good reason your nerve is like dying. So maybe validating his fear and maybe looking at the muscles that are impacted by that peripheral neuropathy and doing strength assessments, maybe before and after his treatment and throughout the course of treatment, to say, hey, you know, your strength is still staying the same, which means you're not damaging anything. You're just getting fatigued, which is, you know, part of what we're trying to treat. So making sure that you kind of frame it in a way that he can see is safe and not damaging, so that his changes he has don't seem terrifying to him and how they've been portrayed to him.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point.
I've got another quick thought if we got time.
Yeah.
One thing that may be helpful, just like fatigue, we know there's definitely a physical component to that, but Julie kind of touched on this with like depression, but also just the psychological nature of fatigue and the perception of work. If there's something fun that he would not put in the category of exercise that you could do, maybe for the home program, maybe in the clinic, that it's like, it's good for him, but he maybe perceives as a lot more fun and interesting. I'm assuming his session is probably a lot of fun when he's in there. But if you can harness some fun, that might be helpful to just like change his perception of what he's doing.
Maybe a little Macarena. I don't know.
Like clock yourself, dance. Yeah, those are great. Some type of game that's going to work on his endurance, but maybe he's got a psychological distraction because he's playing a game instead of like doing reps.
Love it.
These are really helpful. Thanks, guys.
Awesome. Great question. Amber says, are you using freeze as an outcome measure and documenting it regularly, or is it more for your own clinical decision-making? And are you using the criteria to educate those patients that think they're doing fine, but are actually frail? Really great question. So Amber, what a lot of clinicians will do, and a lot of us here at MOA, is that we know Freeds, we know the criteria, we may document it, but a lot of us will lean heavily on that SPPB as well. So that SPPB outcome measure, that short physical performance battery, that under 8 out of 12 is a trait. We can definitely mention Freeds in our documentation, and that's going to warrant, you know, medical necessity. The SPPB carries a lot of weight. If you've ever gone through a Medicare audit, that outcome measure speaks loudly to a lot of auditors. And so we'll definitely use that. You can definitely use Freeds, just the whole Freeds physical phenotype for sure. But I'll definitely make sure that SPPB score is in there if we're going to be talking about frailty. In terms of communicating this with folks, may not necessarily use the F word with patients. You may really have a conversation more about something related more to one rep max living in the sense of, Betty, if we are able to get you as fit as possible, you're going to be able to do XYZ, whatever patient related goal it is. You're going to be less likely to have this issue that you had to come to me for back or sickness or whatever it may be. Speaking more to that context of building their capacity, building their reserve, more around that conversation, not necessarily speaking frailty to them per se. However, when we're talking about speaking to a third party payer, that can be a valuable term and conversation to have with your documentation. Anything else on that MOA?
There was just from the how we're communicating it, there was a qualitative study that looked at what older adults' perception of the word frailty was. And many of them, one of the common themes that came up in these focus groups and interviews was that when we use the frailty word, they assume that their healthcare providers feel like they're a lost cause. That they're kind of at this point of no return. And so I hesitate to use that word with them. And like Dustin said, speak to like the resiliency piece. So yeah, I think we don't want to not acknowledge a person's level of physical function, and we don't want to be like lying or withholding health information, but I think we kind of say all the time, like, you know, your words can harm or your words can heal, and you want to choose wisely. And this is probably one circumstance with our older adults where, you know, that frailty word can be very harmful. So we just have to be careful with that.
Yeah. 100%. Good stuff, y'all. Good questions. Awesome. I love it, y'all. We're off to a great start. Yeah, thanks, Amber. Good question. Great start. Keep using that document. If anything pops up like this, like Micah's question, even though if it's not related to that week, if it's, you know, you're struggling with someone in the clinic, in the home, in the hospital, drop it and we'll be sure to discuss it. Exactly. We are here for you. All right, y'all. Get the tissues out. If you haven't seen this, this is where all the MOA faculty, we turn our videos off because we all start crying at some point during this video. We got to end on a high note here.
Huh?
Man. I don't know what they're selling, Ellen, but yeah, take my money. Take my money, Doc Morris. Golly. It's a pharma company? Of course. Of course it is. All right. Man, that video. Week two, y'all. All right, here's what we got ahead. We're going to dive into the examination process. We're going to talk about the nuances of executing a kind of a geri-bent exam of what are some of the differences that you're going to see compared to a younger individual, for example. What are we thinking about? What are we screening for? How are we going to let that influence our plan of care? We're going to talk about standardization a lot. This is a really big deal when we talk about these functional outcome measures and the double-edged sword of standardization. And then we're just going to give you some of the more evidence-based outcome measures that have a lot of weight behind them. Don't assume that those are these super sexy, complex outcome measures. Some of the most potent and powerful ones we have are some of the simplest. So we're going to use them. All right, so we're going to go through a lot of those that hold a lot of weight that will show that your services are warranted and give you helpful information to inform your plan of care. Once again, use that student question doc. We'll answer any questions next week. Off to a great start, team. If y'all have any questions, feel free to hit us up. Otherwise, we'll see y'all in the Facebook group. Good night. Good work. See y'all next week.